I want to thank y'all for coming out today. Want to make sure y'all understand primary purpose that we're here, get y'all up to speed on what's in the report, answer questions for you, and then give you an opportunity to provide us comments. Comments are very important in the NEPA process, the National Environmental Policy Act process. Those comments will help us determine if the tentatively selected plan that's in this report becomes the recommended plan, or if we need to go a different direction. So this is everyone's opportunity, both us to get y'all's information, y'all to get more information, and to comment. So again, so up here is ways to provide a comment, my address, our fax machine number, email address. This also out front, and we'll bring it around later, a comment card. Fill that out today, leave it here, or talk to someone. Always provide comment after this meeting. Right now, comments are closing tomorrow. And I'll put this back up later so you can get this information. But again, this is your chance to comment. The purpose of the Comp 2 study is to examine an array of alternatives for the reservoir releases for a multi-purpose dam and reservoir project on the Savannah River during droughts. If a better release scenario is identified, the district will implement it as an update to the Savannah drought contingency plan. This is showing Savannah River Basin. And I want to make sure you understand the importance of the whole basin in this study. We're not just interested in what happens in the lakes, all the way down to the harbor. It's all part of what this water does and how we have to use it. Our sponsors with the Corps on the study, Georgia Department of Natural Resources, South Carolina Department of Natural Resources, and the Nature Conservancy. They all played parts of the study, helped us get the information, were partners in meetings as we made decisions. Formulation of alternatives. We looked at starting with a no action alternative. What is being done to manage the water and releases right now? We looked at a broad range of things we could do during drought conditions to manage those waters. What different things could do for different purposes. We developed a series of alternatives. We started out with four. We looked at those four first with no action. From those four, we tried to work more to see if we could get two better ones. We ended up with six alternatives that we completely analyzed and spent a report. We used water withdrawals from 2035, which is based on 20 years of the future, based on predictions from both states, how populations would be growing. I know this table is not readable. We're going to go into a little more detail, but each one of these are the different drought levels. Each is an alternative, working across, no action, over to alternative six. And at each drought level, they do slightly different things. And again, we'll go through this. This chart is up in the front, up here, and is in the report that y'all can get a copy of. But these are how we are different things we were thinking about, ways to control the water and what we do with the water. Each one kind of changed what they were doing, what would be the major goal, how flows would get. So we worked with the natural resource agencies and asked them what they would like to see as part of, ANTNC, I should say, what they would see, like seeing the draft plan, how we would analyze it. We developed a metrics of 53 performance measures to help us understand those impacts and compare them to no action alternatives. I'm not going to read through all the metrics. It looked at everything from power to salinity in the river, geo in the river, geo in the harbor, recreation in the lakes. Could you get your boat in for a ramp on the lakes? Could you get a boat in the lake on the river? All those types of things. Again, a list of 53 different things that we were looking at to do our analysis. Also, we did hydraulic modeling. We had four different types of models that we used. Core started out, looked at model water flows coming out of the lake, how we were controlling the water level. That fed both an ecosystem model up to the side, and a model that was Georgia's that looked at the river. Model the river, fed ecosystem model again, and South Carolina's model in the harbor. So all this was a joint effort, working our way down from releases in the lakes to the harbor. Corps of Engineers were responsible for the multi-purpose project on the lakes and the river. So we wanted to look at all those metrics in a way that would show what those are important to what Congress has told us the lake is for. Flood risk management, hydropower, recreation, environmental stewardship, navigation, water quality, and water supply. All those are missions of the Corps of Engineers when we talk about this lake. Each of the states and TNC have their own priorities of what they're looking at, and they looked at all the data we collected from their own points of view. We used economic factors for hydropower and recreation, because you can get a dollar amount for boat ramps for hydropower generation. Can't do that for ecosystem benefits. So we had to have a method where we could use a common unit. Can't use dollars because you can't determine how many dollars a sturgeon DO improvement is worth. So what we did was a percent change from the no action alternative. So how it changed, how whatever resource we were looking at changed which each alternative compared to no action, compared to existing conditions. That way we had a single unit of currency, not money, not habitat units, percent change. Once the effect on the projects, we were able to compare them. We then ranked them, Corps of Engineers ranked 1 through 7, 7 alternatives, no action included. We looked at all the missions so that we could give each mission a ranking. Corps decided, project delivery team of the Corps decided, no of the missions were more important than any other mission. So hydropower is important as DO in the harbor. You know, because there's no difference. We didn't give one an extra weight, they got 2 points. Every time they were scored, you know, all the equal. So we combined all of those rankings into another big ugly table. So no action alternative is over here on the left. Each alternative walks our way through. Anything that's in red was a negative percent change from no action alternative. So it was worse for that hydropower, recreation, environment, water supply, navigation, flood management, worse for those conditions than the no action alternative. If they're in black, that means they were better or equal to. So we were able to see the percent change and the dollar amount for hydropower for each alternative. You can see that what we decided for recreation, environmental. I'm a little biased here, I'm a biologist, so just know that. We actually decided we were going to split. We did environmental for the lake, for the river, and for the estuary, because they all are reacting differently to these changes. Things that are great for the harbor may not be great for spawning fish in the lake. So it's a trade-off. So we ranked them that way before we got an overall score. So you can see that we scored all of them, including no action, in the process. If they're highlighted green, our ranking, that meant that they were better than no action. So for recreation, alternative 1, 2, and 4 were all better than the no action alternative. Environmental, only alternative 2 was better combined than the no action. This gives you a feeling of how we did it. Then we did a final ranking across the bottom. At the same time, the states and TNC were looking at their data, looking at the same data we were looking at, and coming to their own conclusion of what they supported. We, from the table we saw there, Corps of Engineers, and later with the agreement of the states and the TNC, chose alternative 2 to be the TSP. Remember, tentative selected plan. Today, until tomorrow, this is your chance to make a comment. May or may not help us change it or confirm it. That's what we need up from y'all. So this changed how we were managing the lake. We'll get a chance to y'all can ask specifics of Stan here of how this works. But at each drought level, each elevation of the lake, you change web time during the time of the year, how much water you're releasing. So alternative 2, again, what we think is the TSP, reduces the flows more at each drought level. Raises drought level 3, 2 feet below level 2. Drought level 1, daily average release is 4,000 CFS. Drought level 2, see each one of these are the details of those things. And it varies slightly during the year, release different amounts. And during the summer, benefits of alternative 2, increased hydropower generation. It maintains the pools in the lake slightly higher during droughts. Improves environmental and recreational conditions. Decreases the number of days beaches would be closed in the lake. It increases the number of days boat ramps would be available in the lake. Recreational docks are available for longer duration. It improves fish spawning habitat in the lake because it maintains a stable pool level more during spawning season. It improves flows at Augusta Shoals, an important area of spawning and future spawning of endangered species. And it improves DO levels in the river and the harbor. The other alternatives compared to the TSP. Alternative 1 is the most negative for hydropower. Alternative 3 has the most negative impacts, period. 4 and 6 increase violations of DO in the river and the harbor. This is an issue in the harbor because we're already bumping up against DO standards down there. type five had negative impacts to all project purposes except water supply. Next step. Again, important step, not on this line, your comments. Keep repeating that, it's my job. We're gonna take your, everyone's comments, we're gonna take the agency's, federal state agency's comments. We'll review those, we'll start a response to those comments. We'll develop a final report. That final report will be sent up to our division office in Atlanta. They will approve or not approve that report. Hopefully they will approve it. We will post that report on our website. You will see a spreadsheet of everyone's comments and a response to everyone's comments. As part of it, we put up, it will say what the recommended plan is. Now, if we get huge substantive comment, something that comes out of the blue, we didn't do something wrong. You could stop this process. We would have to go back and look at it, may make changes, may determine no, we did it right, etc. Again, for me, one of the most important slides I think up here, how you can get in touch with me. How you can get us your comments. At the bottom is the website for the Corps of Engineers. This is where we place all our reports. Anytime, not just this project. All our reports on that page. If you want something from the Corps, it's there for Civil Works, it's at that page. So you can see all the other projects we do also. But on that is this report. You can download it, read it. I know it's late for meeting, there are comments tomorrow. Right now, everybody go too quick. If you have questions, we can go back. No questions.
As a co-sponsor, and you all know this, we were working through these scenarios, and a lot of good work happened. And I'm not trying to take away from that. One of George's and I believe South Carolina's QNC's questions and items that we're trying to address chiefly is dissolved oxygen in the harbor. And while these scenarios, two with the way it was done, stack up as the one that is the most effective, there's another scenario, no action alternative, 200 CFS, that's an additional 200 on top, that was run through CORE and also kind of mimicked by the state of Georgia and with the help of South Carolina. And I'm talking increments here of protection. It seems like NNA 200 might be the better fit for addressing DO in the harbor downstream. We would like to say that we need to complete the report and that NNA 200 is something to vet. There was also another alternative, number 7, that seemed to capture a lot of NNA 200 in it. But again, this is for, and we know we have to look at the metrics, the 55,000 that you showed on that slide. But we're asking for more time in which to vet this among the partners and have a sound report as possible in this Comp 2 effort. Not put it off to a Comp 2A or a Comp 3, but drop a contingency plan that's under consideration now.
And I think right now the board's opinion is that we would like to see that formal comment from y'all. And that way we can respond and hopefully be able to answer those questions and look at that information during this comment response period.
Okay, we just sent an email a few days ago with a color-coded
right.
Travel log that shows when the DOs is red. When they don't, during the critical months.
Right.
I hope you can consider that as one of
if y'all
initial
want,
comments.
If you want it as your initial comments,
we'll follow up. Don't get me wrong. We'll fix something by noon tomorrow.
Right.
But I wanted to you know, I'm not trying to speak for the other sponsors, but I think our consensus is that.
Actually, right here first.
I wanted to make just a couple of comments from the standpoint of where Save Our Lakes Now totally is indifference to what the Corps is saying. Just so that other people that maybe want to make comments at least understands where we're coming from. Number one, power is not an enemy, because CEQA will tell you they've got 8 basins. Doesn't care. They don't care where they get it from. The only place power would matter would be in your pockets. Second, man, I just went totally brain dead. Hang on a second. I'll be right back. I can't believe that.
We can come back to you.
Can I come back to you?
Oh, yeah. No.
Thank you.
And then we'll get a chance to put...
Oh, I know. Excuse me. Recreation, in our opinion, you're looking at the wrong things. Your recreation should be including real estate, the draw to this area. And if you do that, you can't measure it the way you've measured it, because you measured in the middle of a problem. It's like a car. If it's got dings all over it, one more ding, you can't tell me what that's worth. If a car has no dings on it, and you put one, you can tell me the value of it. Well, you've measured the effect on recreation right during the middle of the problem. So you can't get a true measure. And last but not least, we feel that fresh water is the major concern. If the aquifers dropped 2 feet, 5 feet, 14 feet, it'd be alarm everywhere. We'd be shutting down users everywhere. We'd be getting out laws to stop this kind of waste. Yet when we do the same thing with the lakes, the Corps keeps trying to justify, well, we need it to, we want to have a little bit more here or a little bit more there. We got these little reasons. And dang it, you don't throw away fresh water in those quantities. Thank you, that's all I need to comment.
Thank you.
Ditto.
Glad you. Originally, the six alternative was a refill alternative. And we were kind of, a lot of us were disappointed a little bit that more wasn't said about a refill, especially with the different levels now that are 2 feet apart in the recommended approach. We were kind of hoping there would be something more said about how that actually would be implemented rather than keeping the same rule when it's 2 feet into the next zone before you raise the flows. We're hoping either some environmental thing or something that would lower the flows until the lakes have recovered. I was wondering if someone could add a little bit more to the refill question.
Looking at my hydraulic engineer over here.
We can try to answer. We often for looking at
can everyone hear him?
I'll try to speak loud now. But
we opted for a combination of the first four alternatives rather than looking specifically at the refill. But the refill before was once you're 2 feet above, you're recovering, and once you're 2 feet above the trigger level, you go to the next higher trigger level's flow requirement or out of ground, depending on which level you're at. Rather than doing that, we kind of migrated the trigger levels higher so that they aren't the same place that they are currently. They're actually starting at Geiger. We flatten them also so they're not seasonally varying, at least with respect to alternative two, which probably makes a little more sense to people on the lake, because they can look out and say, when it gets to this level, I'm in trouble, rather than, you know, a very guide curve. But we did not look at a different kind of trigger for recovery, meaning either based on Broad River, we actually dropped the Broad River out. And possibly, kind of like right now, we've been in 2 months, we're at the high side of the flow trigger band because the Broad River's been flowing high. You know, whereas now, if you take it, get rid of it, and your trigger level 1 is 4,000 CFS, you'd be stuck there. You'd actually be at 3,800. level two. So I think what we looked at actually addresses some of the issues there, but not a transitional rate out of drought, so to speak, for a trigger. I don't necessarily agree that the 2 feet's right or wrong. It's just what we chose because we got a lot of noise around trigger levels. Now we're going to get a lot of noise around back drought.
Okay. All right. Thanks.
I'd like to understand what methodology was used to arrive at the $3,400 positive impact that alternative two had, because I know at my own marina that can double every month. So instead of being just $3,400 for your whole analysis, or $3,185, my revenue can jump $6,000 a month, depending on where we are on the lake level. So I'd like to understand how you arrived at that recreation number. And if you could hold your mic closer to your mouth, it would help us.
And unfortunately, our economist is not here. Can get you an answer on how that is done. I believe it is explained in the document. And this is average annual dollars. This would mean it is for the period of analysis that we ran for the whole time, broken down what the average for during drought years and non-drought years that were in that air time of analysis, what the gain.
Well, you obviously didn't inquire to the five marinas that are on the lake. I never got a questionnaire that said, what effect does drought have on your revenue? So, I mean, if you're only counting five core boat ramps, that's not a valid measure at all.
If it was all of the boat ramps, including the marina boat ramps, and it was accessibility, based on the numbers, of the invert of the ramp and when the ramp would become unusable. And so it counted the number of days for each alternative that the ramp was unusable with a specific alternative's operations.
Who gave you my data?
We got these a long time ago with the Duke, or 2012 2014, somewhere in there. We got the inverts of the ramps. It's like 54 ramps.
My question is, who provided my data?
The economics data was based on, the value was based on a standardized process that I would have to get to you. There's an economics appendix that talks about how that works. I'm sorry, I can't answer that one.
It ties visitation into usage, meaning the number of annual visitors we have, and assuming that these visitors are using the boat ramps, or something of that sort, then they came up with a dollar value per visit and ended up with an average annual value for all the visitors per year.
I understand even the 5 million number during that period is suspect and is being recalculated.
Right.
And out of that number, there was 1,395,000 boaters and 835,000 fishermen. And I think they're going to contribute more than $3,185.
Here's the good thing about that. The 3,000 doesn't really mean anything. Because remember the way that they ranked it was, is it better or worse? We've got $100 million of hydropower impact, or $1 million of hydropower impact, that's the same. Is it better or worse for that particular alternative? Better or worse than NAA?
So none of them are weighted? You don't have any of these factors, or they're not weighted?
Okay. So they treated them all the same, each congressional authorized purpose.
And you wrote that alternate plan two because it had the most number of positive impacts, period.
I don't think you're answering my question. Back in that time period, I had like 30,000 visitations a month. So out of that, how did you decide what my boat rank was doing?
It's an economist question. Sorry.
Because we could determine the lake level, we knew that invert in the bottom of your ramp, we could determine for all the ramps that we had data on, which we, I assume we had the data on yours, we determined where when that boat ramp would no longer be in service.
What is it for mine, do you know?
The elevation or the number of users?
No, I'm saying, you said when my boat ramp's not going to be usable, then the drought came back in six or something, I extended that boat ramp to a low level of 318. When the lake hit that level, we extended our ramp and redid it. So all these lake levels, we have the ability to launch a 50-foot houseboat, no matter what the lake level is.
Right.
And I'm saying that value just is ridiculous. Yes.
Well, all the elevations are updated. But again, the value has nothing to do with it. It's whether it's relatively positive from the no action or negative. Was it a benefit or was it an impact?
And we're willing to talk with you after. Let's move on, get other people's questions, and write your concern down, comment down. We'll bring it into the document. We'll have our economist look at it, and he'll be able to respond directly. Yes?
So I have a question. Everything's compared to the no action alternative. In the draft document that the partners got, when you described the no action alternative, you talked about a 200, and it was a 2014 agreement. What was that? And that language is not in the current document. So could you please explain to me the language that was in the draft document that described the no action alternative in the February 2017 draft document that the partners read?
We in a 200, which we've discussed, and that is a modeled version of the 200 CFS mitigation that was picked up when Duke did their relicensing. Okay, we redid a storage balance agreement with Duke, and it impacted the downstream. So, in the process of doing that, EPD discovered that roughly 11 days of 200 CFS would mitigate the associated impacts of that change. Okay, so that was sitting out here. It was never modeled. It's an after, this was comments.
But it was in the draft document that we read. That was the description of the NAA. The February document.
It may have been in that brief draft document that you looked at. The modeling that we did.
Well, I know what you did, because I understand that.
Right, that's
all. The NAA description that was in the draft version that we read and reviewed was the NAA 200. Is that correct?
No, the NAA 200 was not modeled in the draft version.
But it was described in the draft.
And that was one of the corrections we made to be accurate for this document. Yes, that was a comment.
All right, so the NAA document that you have there is worse than the condition that we use to develop the 5R.
Yes.
For the Savannah Harbor.
It's not NAA 200.
Right. The NAA, I just want to point this out, the NAA that is used, so every comparison is to the NAA, but that NAA is worse than what was used to develop the 5R. So I don't have as much application available to me in Harvard because they're using a different baseline. And Georgia has a concern regarding that. That we need to make sure that the appropriate baseline is being used for comparison. When you're looking at the harbor, an agreement that was worked out with many stakeholders and what they have to do in terms of production.
I concur that your NAA 200 should be the baseline. It was a timing thing. If you recall, during the study, during the process,
We did an NAA, and the 200 round here was an additional mitigation outside of the modeling.
Right, so I...
Then we came along and we did another study where we did an NAA 200 after that. But it was a little bit further down the process of getting to this point.
Right.
So it didn't slow us down. So now we're here with the NAA. Your comments to us that I'm hearing are, can we, as part of this wrap-up, make sure that we use an NAA 200 as the benchmark or no action?
Right, as the appropriate baseline. My recommendation, and I guess Jory, Jeff pointed this out, is we would like the additional time to finish the appropriate evaluation that needs to be done on the NAA.
I think we are working that direction.
Okay, just want to make sure.
The process is, we want to get this legal document out, get comments, so people have an idea. If we have a substantive change, we'll either have to republish this document or not, depending on how that varies from what we do. But this is still a valid process. And yes, we are aware of your issues.
Right.
And we're not saying that there's not issues. I'll wait in the back.
Hey, my name is James Solomer. I'm a reporter with the Augusta Chronicle, and I'm here today to write a story about this meeting. I wonder if you could talk a little bit about what this alternative would mean for the riverfront development in both cities, and perhaps why regular folks should be interested in it or care about it.
For cities, you say both cities, for Augusta, Georgia, South Carolina?
Augusta, North Augusta.
Yeah, okay.
Yes. Where you are.
No problem. It will affect the flows down the river. It does not theoretically affect the pool. What will have more of an impact will end up being our design of a fish bypass. Okay? In other words, our drought plan flows that we're going to, we go all the way to a 3,100 CFS in the wintertime before we trigger level 3. We've already done that in the past. We're going to continue to do that in the future with the alternative, so it really shouldn't make much of an impact.
Could you translate that CFS business into English?
Cubic feet per second.
I mean, well, so, what does that mean? How would I, as a person who is interested in the river, how would I see that? How might that affect me? And, you know, why should I hear? I got one day comment.
No problem.
What should I do?
If you go out here and look at the pool, and we're releasing 3,100 CFS or 8,000 CFS, you're not going to see a big difference. At least not in the elevation of the pool. You'll see a little bit of difference in the velocity of the water through the pool. If you go downstream of the lock and dam into a section of the river that is not, so to speak, regulated by another structure below it, you'll see a little bit of difference in elevation. So, from that perspective, you're not going to see a big difference through the downtown areas here.
What do you mean by pool? Which pool? Where?
From the lock and dam up to the shores.
Augusta.
Yeah.
The Augusta pool.
Okay, what does the effect have on Clark Hill?
Each of the alternatives has a different effect on the minimum elevation at the worst point of the drought, or of the drought period that we analyzed.
As a property owner, you know, we want stabilize lake levels. How does this plan achieve that? Yeah.
Different ones do different things. Okay. Alternative two, it's a little hard to do without the output, but in the report, if you look, you got some plots and you kind of see what it does. It doesn't go down as far for as many days, those kind of things. Some of the other alternatives pretty much keep it full, but they kill the downstream.
Well, I mean, we want to balance things out. We're not going to be greedy, but what we look at, just like the newspaper man, is regular people who don't understand all the science behind it, is we look at area lakes other than the core-controlled lakes, and they're all stable within about a foot all year long, and we'd like to know, what is the core doing to try to stabilize all the lakes within a foot all year long, like
they're
all
not
the lakes?
They're not, they don't care.
That's what, as a property owner, that's what we care about.
Well, there's other lakes that you're looking at, like George Power Lakes, okay? And they have one thing in mind. Okay? They own a lot of property on the lake. Or it's their property around the lake, and they're selling it, they're developing it, they're also creating power, they're using that pool for their generation.
Right.
Meaning not through the project, through the dam, but a steam plant that's adjacent to the pool. So they don't really have much of a desire to adjust the pool or pull it down because it impacts their ability, the values of the land and stuff like that. They do have a minimum flow requirement that they have to meet. But that's about it. We got multi-purpose projects and we have to meet all these different congressional authorized purposes. And in doing that, we're trying to balance the impacts somewhat to the authorized purposes. Recreation is one of them. The value of the property around a federal reservoir is not one of them, but the access to that federal reservoir is.
What is your definition of recreation?
Access to the federal reservoir.
Which has nothing to do with the value of the lake as recreation. As people build for recreation, people come because the lake is up. Those are recreation, not how far a boat ramp sticks in the water. You're using the wrong measure, that's why you're getting the wrong answer.
Thank you, sir, for your comment. I don't want to get into an argument with anyone here. Okay, I'm trying not to get that stirred up. That's why I wanted to calm him down for a minute. So, because we're trying to get all the information. And we understand that everyone has different concerns. And we understand, but you also have to see that there is laws that your congressman that you can go to change, tell us what we have to do.
Yeah.
And right now, our laws are to balance those purposes. So I'm going to move on. I had a question back here, I believe, earlier. Yes.
I had a follow up on his comments on what the appropriate baseline should be. NAA or this NAA 200, and this is more for Stan, I guess. If you do decide that the NAA 200 is the appropriate baseline, does that mean that all the alternatives have to be rerun with this 200 CFS provisions in it?
No.
It seems like it would have to be.
No. Because we're not going to do the additional 200 CFS on top of the other alternatives. Meaning, we're going to do the baseline as it is now. We've already done it, actually. We've modeled the NAA 200. Georgia has the results of that. We'll get the results back. We have to reevaluate using that as the baseline and comparing it to the other alternatives.
But each alternative should have all the provisions that we can build into to compare apples to apples.
No. No, we're saying the 200 CFS is no longer different. Okay, and this is your new operating.
So you need to take away that provision from the 200. It is
correct.
Correct. Is Duke agreeing with that?
That is for them to comment.
You just can't take it away then.
Yes. Okay. In other words, it's our proposal. If they come back and say no, then it's no. Or we'll have to defend it. But there was no reason to add another 200 CFS on top of alternatives that we did a whole lot of change on. Each one of these alternatives are significant changes. So why do 200 CFS plus a significant change?
Because you're trying to compare it to the NAA, which has the 200 CFS.
The NAA with the 200 CFS will be up there. It'll be the first one.
But the NAA that's up there had agreements that to do certain things that are not part of all these other agreements either now, all these other alternatives. It is a change from whatever the baseline ends up being, I'm not going to go to either one, to these new plans and how they affect the total ecosystem, human and environment that we're looking at. So if we wanted a alternative that drained the pool and provided 100% hydropower as best they could, we could develop that and not worry about any other agreement, not worry about planning. Or if we wanted an alternative that only kept water in the pool and didn't worry about, you know, flooding downstream, that could be developed. And that's an agreement when we come together as a group. And all that would be compared to
the existing, whatever we determine that to be, no action alternative.
Okay. Assume that the assumption is that you can change the duty frequency, and that's not going to be an issue.
Correct.
There's okay, certain assumption, I guess that's okay.
There's certain. There's certain facets about the Duke agreement we're not going to impact. And those have to do with elevations of the Huey pool, things that would cause Huey to go offline because something.
Okay.
When I was a kid, I'd like to build a pool level at 332. What kind of roof would you do?
Could you give that mic?
Can't hear it. When I was a kid, I was playing that level, it was 332, so I asked 330. And then I've been told once before that all the orange markers around the lake, those four property markers, in case the lake was flooded, that as high as the water level would go. And then, you know, because the bill thing. In the 70s, the lake never fluctuated like it does now. It keeps saying it's environmental, but I don't know what's happened. Here, January, the lake is full, water's gone.
So he asked what the original elevation that we control the water at.
It's always been 330 on the high side. I think the bottom of the pool, the bottom of the conservation pool, might have changed from 296 to 312. But that was 1950s.
Yeah. It fills itself up. And here it is, a drought almost at the end. It's rained every day. Water in January, the lake was full, and then it just drops. I mean, it's like it's just somebody turned the thing open and let it all out. Looks like to me, the river flow, let it stay there.
That is actually the intent of these drought plans, is to keep it from fluctuating so much.
And they say you have to have water quality in the river and everything else, and I understand that, but as long as water's moving, it's water quality.
Well, the mineral flows that are in these drought plans kind of set what the water quality and whether or not we're impacting the downstream. So we're trying not to go so low that we have a big negative impact or we won't be picking that alternative.
Yeah, and you know, like when it dropped to 314, that was almost a disaster. Here, I mean, pulling water out of mud, it's just a bad time. But along with Canada, they looked at an emergency plan, so that won't help. I mean, won't happen.
We were told it wasn't a recreational lake and they didn't care about the people on the lake. I'm tired of my dog sitting on dirt and my husband having to go and mow the grass around the dock. And then it will come up and it comes up so fast. I'm looking at flowers blooming underwater and then it will go down so quickly. We're back in on dry land again. Why did you let the water out this past, what, January and February? We even went up to the dam and just watched the water just flow away. And now we have not been able to enjoy the lake not one time this year, but my taxes haven't come down. Now you'll tell me to go to the county for that. But, so that, you know, it's back and forth. But, is it for recreation? Y'all can bring in lots of money. You've chased many projects away. Bass Pro left with their bass fishing tournament every year. We're losing revenue. We watched the little stores close up. We watched people go bankrupt. What is it? You call it a recreational lake and you want us to be there, but there's nothing to be there for.
So one of the authorized purposes is recreation. Now,
definition of recreation, and I don't want to offend you here, but it's different from what landowners who are just off the lake, and I'm going to remind you of that because it is an important part, think recreation is. We are not responsible to maintain the value of your property that you own adjacent to the lake. That is not what we define, federal government defines as recreation. So that is part of a perception that is different from how the federal recognizes it. So, you know, I understand you want to live on a lake. It's great, it's a beautiful view.
I'd like to see the lake.
I understand it. I would like to see it too.
But this hazard, I mean, the tree, I mean, I'll never know where that this stump up that high people. That's where I was coming up.
We agree with what you're saying. It is hazardous, a lot of things. Some of these alternatives are going to benefit what you're saying. In other words, they'll bring the lake higher more of the time.
Yeah, but, you know, when they cut the trees off, they anticipate that that would clean half for some reason.
All right, so we got 5 more minutes for questions and answers, and we can continue the conversation after, but then we want to have an hour where people or other people can have a chance to have a conversation with different
people. And what we want y'all to do, please, there's cards back there in the back. There are email address up there. We want the comments written down so we can capture them so that we can respond to you and have it in your record. Got two questions coming at you, and then all the way over there next.
I just want to ask Stan one question. How long have you been balancing the basin?
Since
as long as I can remember.
Since 86.
86? Yeah. Okay. Why don't you have more gray hair?
There you go.
It's called
before after Lake Russell.
I do.
That before after Lake Russell.
I actually worked on Russell during co-op when I was going to college, so that Russell came in 83-ish.
I think there's a perception that since Russell was built, we've had these wild fluctuations. Is that accurate?
Russell actually helps the system a lot because it allows us to use pump back storage and generate and reduce our releases from our pump. So it helps keep the pools higher. To mitigate impacts to the federal government, meaning electricity.
Got a question or comment over here, question.
Well, I'd like to commend you for anything you can do to level the lake. We're dropping it up and down. It tears up a lot of things, including our boats. We carry them up there, or docks if you have them. But, so, I'm not sure 200 is even enough. Maybe you ought to, you know, you ought to drop the flow even more. One thing we can do around here, right over the I-20 bridge, and I can tell you when Clark Hill is being drained. Strong firm control. If there's a lot of rocks out there, the flow is about right. When you don't see any rocks, you can bet it's coming down. And we all wonder, of course, how Murray, Sinclair, Oconee, Greenwood, all of them stay full. And Lake Lanier, it's not on this thing, but it's always empty, or frequently, I'm sorry. Clark Hill seems to be the worst, so it goes down and it just stays down. But I would like to commend you for anything you can do to kind of level the lake. Thank you.
Thank you all for the input.
You got one. I want to say one thing, Ken, to speak out. And I'll say it in defense, and I will give the Corps credit for one thing. You do keep my lake pristine. I'm in Clark Hill. I'm a landowner. So you do keep the lake pristine. You keep a lot of development out of it. You keep it where you don't have a tremendous amount of trash in the lake, if you will. I'm just going to use that term openly. But the question I have in relation to most of these folks have said, we do have a lot of lakes around here. Yes, they are regulated by different entities, power companies and so forth, but they're always full. They don't change much. They may be a little cloudier, whatever, but they don't change the levels often. You go up around Hartwell, around Clark Hill, I mean, you could just about have a racetrack around that thing. There's so much clay out there, you know? But it seems like to me the focus on things is with getting back to what you came here for. This alternative two, will it give us, in us layman's people, us people that don't understand a lot of the acronyms that you use to put all this together, and all the money that you spend to put all these studies together that we all pay out of pockets for, every one of us, including, you know, will it give us more water in the summer for recreation? Will it maintain a higher level through the spring and through the fall at the same points? I understand draw down to a point to maintain for the possibility of flood or what have you, like we all got kind of caught not too long ago and got a lot of water in the lake. But will this alternate plan give us better lakes? Yes. And on top of this, there's another factor too that we're looking into is some wastefulness from the Corps side. You run around, you worry about people putting rocks in their backyard or chairs on the beach versus needing to go out and mark shoals that are now visible that shouldn't be visible, that are now, which becomes boater safety, not recreation. So things like that is something that I think a lot of people would like to see happen when it comes to, I mean, it's not hard for you to go out and mark a shoal. Y'all got stuff to do it with. You got rock piles out there on either side of Ridge Road now that are just, if a guy's not positive and he's out there having fun, there he goes. And he could kill somebody in front of his boat, let alone tear his boat up. But we ain't worried about tearing up people's boats, I understand. We're worried about life safety. So those things is where I'm coming from with this. If we get this alternative to and we do go in this direction, will we keep a fuller lake so we won't have to worry about all these shoals?
Short answer is yes. And come up afterwards and look at these two charts. And you can see the difference between what our current plan has as far as trigger levels and what the proposed plan does. It raises the trigger levels to a lower flow at a higher pool. So we will go into a conservation mode earlier. Level one does not mean we're in drought. This is guide curve. I mean, this is where we are. That's flood pool right there. It's just, this is where we have to respond to a possible drought coming up. If we don't cut back at that point in time, it's going to be a lot lower.
So you're saying an anticipated drought coming
correct.
Up, not a...
Correct. That's like, the gist of
it. So you're at 324 and a half today, pretty much. Everybody else is full. Russell runs about a foot difference most of the time. And usually when Russell's a foot down, it's because Clark Hill's been sucked back out of Clark Hill.
You can't use Russell as an example because no, it doesn't have the same balancing that Harpwell and Russell, than Harpwell and Thurman do.
Right. Okay. So, but are we going to have a little bit better pool so we don't have to put all these shoulders?
Correct.
I'll just add on to that though, that these natural droughts, we can't add water to it. So it will improve. But we don't want to set the expectation that, you know, we can't predict when these extreme rain deficits will occur. And when they do occur, they're more than a year, in this last case, 15 months at a time.
We spend a little money on the shells now.
We're at flood stage.
Yeah.
Just last.
In 1 year, we went from flood stage, and we had to run people off of our campground in Duffy County because it was flooding. And a year later, we're 10 people
low. In that one year, we had a 27-inch rain deficit, which is roughly 50% of what is normal.
And something unique about that, we went straight from a significant flood in December of 2015 to the next 4 months were like drought rainfall.
Yeah, but then you had three, 4 months of over average.
It pretty much stayed below that until later on in the year.
That's not what your website, George.
The website.
I can shift to the boards I run the website. But I think we're going to shift to a more of a social mingling point in this phase. And if you want to talk to Stan or Nathan or me or anyone else in the States, then now's your chance.
I want to thank y'all again. I'm going to put up the slide with the contact information one more time. Please, either fill out a comment card and leave it today. Take the card, mail it to us. Take your own email address and send me an email. We will write this up.
We'll get y'all something. Those are in the report that's online. These are just bigger versions of people can have all the
still
going. You've been. I haven't seen you.